Hi, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good night to all of you. Preeti Shah, and
I am
me.
Dr. Prajakta Vaidya.
We are going to talk to you today regarding how homeopathy is special and unique in its own way. We're doing this as part of this that we are kind of organized, and we are very, very grateful. And I think the event was amazing, and we're so happy and glad to be part of this. Prajakta and I have been practicing for the last, over a decade now. And from homeopaths, from being healers, we really are so passionate about what we do. And it's important for us to let the general public homeopathy is different from the conventional medicine and what it has to offer. Today's talk is about giving that clarity to people, and I'm going to quickly go ahead and share my screen. Just give me a moment. That happens. All right. So I think my screen. There are many reasons why homeopathy is special. It's a very gentle science. I mean, there are absolutely no side effects. You know, a one day geriatric population with cancer, everybody can take homeopathy, and there are absolutely no side effects. It's completely natural. Unlike many other forms of medicine, homeopathy does not give an only symptomatic relief. You know, it's not that you have a headache. If you are having fever, you're just not popping up a paracetamol to reduce your fever. It's more holistic. The whole idea of homeopathy is to go to the root cause and heal your vital energy, your prana, your immunity to take care of your well-being. And one of the ways how homeopathy helps is in its unique case-taking mechanism. Yeah. So for those who have used homeopathy, you all know that, you know, more often than not, your homeopath will sit with you, and you know, there will be like a detailed, you know, 45 minutes to 1 hour to 2 hours discussion on not just your disease, you know, not just the label of your complaint, but also understanding you as a person, you know, the one who is suffering. Yeah, not just the label of the disease. Today, we would like to talk about this beautiful tool of case taking that homeopaths use, you know, to find a remedy that's going to heal you from within. Now, case taking is adopted by several other, you know, doctors and healers. Yeah, everybody would want to understand you, you know, your name, your, you know, gender, your age. Do you have any medical history? Did you have any family history? You know, and things like that. And also, you know, all the details of your complaints. You know, laboratory investigations are done. Your CT scan or X-ray, etc. is done. It's all part of your case record form. Your case taking. But homeopaths don't just do that. We go much deeper, you know. We address issues which are completely seemingly unrelated to your complaints. And we do that because we want to individualize you and find your individualistic remedy. Dr. Alexis Carrel, he's a Nobel Prize winner. And he says in his book, Man the Unknown, the disease is not simply an entity. Yeah, disease is more, it's a personal event in a way that there are as many diseases as there are number of patients. So doesn't matter you have a migraine, you have a PCOS, you have a uterine fibroid, you have hypertension, diabetes, rheumatoid arthritis. For the homeopath, what is unique in that rheumatoid arthritis and who sufferer who is having this rheumatoid arthritis is more important. Yeah. So we do this detailed understanding of who you are along with the details of your complaints, and that helps us to find your individualistic remedy. And when we do that, we don't just collect your symptoms. You know, it's not like, you know, somebody is sitting with a register and okay, this take, you know, it's not robotic. It's not simply data collection. The way homeopaths do it is very artistic, and it is very scientific to understand the deeper realms of the source of your illness. Yeah. This case taking process for several homeopaths and, you know, their clients or patients is such a beautiful journey of self-inquiry and self-discovery that, you know, the case taking itself is half the job done. Half the healing could be achieved only through this case taking mechanism. Yeah. And the homeopath really aims at finding this fundamental perception of your underlying thoughts, your feelings, your experiences, and your symptoms. And it's not just psychology, you know, it's not just your mental symptoms. It's much deeper than your mind, much deeper than your body. It's an underlying experience, an underlying thread that runs through and through your entire being. Yeah. And this understanding helps the homeopath to find your unique remedy. Yeah. Prajakta, you want to add something?
So to start with, it's the case record form. We also do take all the preliminary data, considering your name and the age. Then there are medical histories of you, if you have in the past, or your family histories, having any complaints or any chronic diseases if your parents or, you know, grandparents have. And the chief complaint, what complaint that you've come up with. And not only the chief complaint, but the details related to it. Like, you know, if there's a pain in head, what is something that aggravates or, you know, increases the pain? He asked that. Is there what makes him feel better apart from the medicine? Are there any concomitant, like, are there any associated symptoms along with that? Like, generally with the headache, you have pain, like the watering of the eyes, or at times you have anger, irritability, what all those things which qualify your chief complaint. We also take that, especially in acute complaints, you know, like fever, diarrhea, which are short-term origin, those become very important for us. Then the physical general. From there, actually, the individualization starts, like, you know, about the appetite and the sleep pattern, in fact, sleep position, dreams that we get, or fears, yes, and then hobbies, and then nature, overall, how that person is. You know? So all these things come up from that patient is also very important in the initial time. Yeah. And then it varies with the type of the patient that we are dealing with. Like, if, you know, every homeopath will have its own style, as well as it might differ with the kind of a patient that we have. Because for child, we have a different technique of taking the case. Maybe, you know, they just talk about any story which, you know, fascinates them, any hobbies or any particular fear, and
they fight they had with his or her best friend in the school, you know.
Yes, and they describe it, you know, to the very detailed manner, that's what we have seen. And then there were several pathological conditions. At that time, the complaints, they become more important. If patients are in coma, then maybe the observation and the history given by the attendant becomes very important for us. For pets, these days we are seeing many animals as our patients. So there, how every dog is different, you know, uniquely, we are understanding that. So it's all is a part of case taking, and then it varies with the patients.
So each homeopath has his or her own unique style of case taking, and it also differs from the kind of patient, the kind of complaints that the patient has. So there is no one size fit all, you know. There is individualization even in the mode of case taking. Yeah. So in general, if we see the case taking process, would also go in, you know, layer by layer, deeper and deeper and deeper. So you would generally start with, you know, like, hi, hello, how are you? What's your name? And, you know, okay, what complaints do you have? And since when do you have this complaint? Okay, you know, is it on the right leg on the or the left leg? You know, certain names and facts, you know, which is very objective reality. And from this objective reality, you're going to the subjective reality. You know, you're going deeper. So how does it feel when your BP shoots up, you know, or how does it feel when you're really angry? And then from there, you go much deeper into imagination. You go into the vital sensation and energy. So because we are not just dealing with the names and facts, I mean, I don't, as homeopaths, we are not treating you only for your peptic ulcer. We are not dealing, you know, helping you with just the allergic rhinitis that you have. You're not just aiming to reduce your coryza or reduce your cough or reduce your fever. We are going much deeper to see what is the cause of it and how it is manifesting it. So it's like, just imagine, like you see this picture over here. It's like you're going deeper. It's a labyrinth. You're going inner and inner and inner. You're going to the very center, like an onion. You peel and go layer by layer inside. So case taking would also go from, you know, outside inside. I mean, certain patients would go directly to the vital cells. I mean, you may start at level 5, level 6 directly, you know, depends on at which plane the patient is. But in general, all spheres of our life can be categorized into these 7 layers. And these are beautifully explained by Dr. Rajan Shankaran. And doesn't matter. I mean, I also wanted to see, because, you know, if you've gone to several homeopaths in the past, you know, not everybody is going to go or use the same mechanism. You know, somebody may just take, you know, your case taking or your consultation may just last for 10 minutes. And that's about it. And, you know, and some homeopath may say, spend like a couple of hours with you. But doesn't matter, you know, it's like, you know, you're looking at this room and no matter which window you look through, you're still looking at the same room. So, you know, whether you look at the patient from level 1 or you look at, you know, a much deeper level of energy or vital sensation, you're looking at the same thing. Each homeopath with his or her own experience would use a different mechanism, and doesn't matter what window you're looking from, you're looking at the same room, yeah, to the same very center. What Prajakta, just before I hand it over to you, what Prajakta and I would like to do is that this time that you and, you know, like you as a client or patient and us are spending together, we want to make this time also very meaningful. Yeah, not just the end or the objective, you know, it's not like you come and I'm going to give away this small remedy bottle to you and that's about it. But the process of reaching that goal, that also is very, very equally important to us. And that camaraderie that, you know, in the consultation room that you and us bring together is also a journey, beautiful journey in itself. So most of the patients that we see would go much deeper. And, you know, but I mean, of course, if there are patients, you know, with acute complaints and things like that, we would have a short case taking history, etc. Especially now with this whole COVID thing, you know, we would speak to patients on the phone over Skype, just 10 minutes. And that's about it. So let's study this a little bit deeper so that you understand that what really the homeopath is doing. Yeah. And this talk that you're doing is not just helpful for, you know, general public, also, you know, young budding homeopaths, you know, who are new to this science. And I think you're going to gather a lot and understand a lot from this. So, you know, just hang around and, you know, you'll see how we take this forward.
Yeah. So the first level, you know, we're talking about the name and the fact. And we just spoke about there are homeopaths who just give 10 minutes or, you know, initial history. So that initial history is also coming through the patient, you know. So there are possibilities of having some unique and peculiar complaints or peculiar symptoms at that level too. So they might be describing about their migraine. They will generally come and tell you, okay, oh, I have a migraine, or I want a treatment for allergy, or, you know, I have stones in my left kidney. So these are the name and the facts of the complaint that they describe, you know. And then they describe a lot about the modalities like, you know, the headache or the allergies are more in winter, or, you know, they are more in the morning or evening. They can tell you the particular time, or it is better, my acidity is better by having cold milk. And at times, all the preliminary data that we take. But at this level also, maybe in the diagnosis, there are very peculiar diagnoses with the patient can come up, you know. So this level will give you the idea of the disease, the name, facts, and the modalities. But also we look for any peculiar complaint, or also if anything peculiar that is coming up at this level.
For example, somebody may say that I get a sty, and I get recurrent styes, but always on the right eye, on the upper eyelid, on the outer side. Now, this is so unique and so peculiar. I mean, it's a fact. It's a name level, but there is such peculiarity in it that it always occurs on the right side, on the right eye, on the upper eyelid, on the right, on the lateral end of it. So, you know, such peculiarities at the name and fact level. Yeah.
Yeah, so these generally we use for keynote prescriptions at time when there are less time, or, you know, acute cases. And with the experiences, we come up with some clinical tips, like what we have seen with our practice, that uranium nitricum is best for, you know, chemotherapy side effects, or sulfur is the best medicine to start for anybody of alcoholic addiction, or, you know, most of our ringworm cases are better with tellurium and then intercurrent bacillin. So these are the clinical tips or the experiences that we can generate or experience during this level of the case taking as well.
So a lot of young homeopaths, you know, you use this experience that other homeopaths have had for several years, and in clinical practice you've seen that this works definitely. So, you know, and a lot of, you know, senior homeopaths, they've seen so many hundreds and thousands of patients that those 5 minutes interaction with the patient can give them, you know, a picture of that inner room. You know, they're looking at the from one of those windows with such experienced eye that they can still identify that uniqueness, that peculiarity. Yeah. So at name and fact level, the keynote prescriptions and clinical tips, you know, generally come from here. Like, for example, the genus epidemicus debate that we are having at this point in time during the COVID-19. How camphora and arsenic albumin, Brian Yuan, gelsemium. So several homeopaths from their experience in whichever part of the world they are, they're seeing some common symptoms that come. And without going to the deeper levels of energy or feeling or delusion, we are still able to find the unique remedy for that particular patient. So that's a keynote prescription at the level of name and fact. Yeah.
Can you go more deeper to name and the fact? You go more deeper level of feeling or the emotions. And we must tell you that in the last decade or the 12 years of our experience, we've never seen only a patient with will tell you, okay, I have just this headache. They were always describing, okay, you know, with this headache, I'm just irritated, or I'm just angry, I just feel like, you know, sleeping, or I just feel like weeping all the time. So this is the experience that patients get with their chief complaint. So this is a level of experience which is, you know, generally very common. We see this. Most of us are living at this level of the experience. Right, and this is also this emotional level, the feeling level is the base of these facts or the name, right? So for example, like, you know, if you see the facts or the patient is talking about money or accounts, then the things to do with the finance, then it may be coming from the fear, you know, deeper fear or the emotion of having fear of poverty, or You know, if patient is talking about family, friend, and the relationship, it must be talking of his experience of being hurt or being disappointed. So it is always based on the name and the facts is also based on a deeper level of feeling or the emotion. So commonly these, we see it like anger, irritability, and the confusion, fears, you know, this is a very common thing that we see. And then we, how do we understand that? So once if we see a particular emotion, which is, you know, very, it is coming with your complaint, then we ask them to describe this feeling mode. You know, how does that emotion feel like to him or her? Qualify the emotion more and more. Go deeper into the anger or the emotional level. And generally, we get an idea of this level through these windows which we are talking about, you know, the fears or the dreams or the hobbies. Or we ask them about any intense situation that have taken place in their life. Or any incident which, you know, they remember and they talk about. And then from there, they can go more deeper into it and, you know, getting a deeper experience through that emotional level.
I just wanted to add one point is that the more you ask or the more the homeopath asks to qualify a particular feeling or experience, you go to the next level. So the more you ask about the name and facts, more likely you are going to go deeper to the next level of feeling or the next or further down. So the more qualifying a particular thing gets, the deeper you go to the next level.
Yes.
Yeah. And I also just want to say that, you know, at what level your case taking happens with the homeopath, not just dependent on what the client or the patient wants. Sometimes it's also dependent on what level the homeopath is. You know, if I'm a kind of a homeopath who's living my existence at the level of feeling, most of my homeopathic prescriptions are at the level of feeling. Yeah, so it's actually such a beautiful journey that we don't know who is healing whom.
Yeah.
Who is the healer and who is the one who's getting healed, you don't know. Yeah. All right. So as Prajakta was saying, the name and facts are dependent on the feeling. If you analyze this feeling a little more, you will realize that these feelings, these emotions are coming from a deep-rooted delusion or a deep-rooted imagination, which is beyond happiness, which is beyond anger, which is beyond sorrow. It's like you're seeing an outer reality with your own individual unique perception, and that perception comes from the glasses that you're wearing, you know. So, you know, I could be wearing green glasses and, you know, Pratikta wears red glasses and somebody wears black glasses. So my perception of the reality is through the green glasses, which gives me a feeling of anger. Yeah. So, for example, some patient would say the pain is as if it's like a punch in my abdomen. Not everybody of us is going to be saying this. So what is this punch? Or somebody may say that, you know, my mother-in-law is not just harsh. She is like a Hitler. You know, she is so cruel. So it's like my perception of my mother-in-law is as if like a Hitler. You know, my mother is so catty. She is like cat. You know, the perception is as if. It's not what it is. It is as if it is like that. And that distorted perception of the reality is often the cause of the misery that we live in, you know, and that this is the lack of well-being comes from this distorted perception of reality.
And then we carry that, you know, with us all over our life.
And it is not unique to a particular situation, you know. This delusion or imagination runs through and through our life, you know. Then not just the mother-in-law is a Hitler, you know. Any such situation will give a similar sense of
being sensitive
to cruelty or, you know, similar sense of experience. And it runs through and through the patient's level of existence. And how do you know it's a delusion, it's not a reality, or it's not a fact, or it's not a feeling, is that when the patient generally says, or the client would generally say, it's as if, you know, it's like this, you know. So I'll just give you an example. So, you know, we had a patient the other day, and, you know, she says that so she lives here in Mumbai, and, you know, the mother-in-law lives elsewhere in some other part of the country. So, you know, once in a year, the family would come and live with the patient. So when they come and live, she feels that my freedom is restricted, and I feel really angry when she is coming and bossing around me in my own house. So we say, how does that feel? It's as if in my own house, in my own den, she's making me feel like an outsider. So my house is no longer house. It's my den. And it's as if I'm in my own den, in my own territory, and somebody is making me feel that I'm an outsider. And you are the king in your territory, in your den, and I'm threatened and I'm angry by somebody else who's invading it. So this is much deeper. It's not a simple mother-in-law coming. I mean, the anger gets qualified in a way that it is so beautiful, and it goes deeper. And then you will see that the same feeling, the same, feeling comes in different spheres and different situations, different stresses at work, you know, in the relationships, and, you know, in so many other, in the dreams, in the fears, in the hobbies, everywhere this common thread is running. Yeah. So this is also, this is the level that is getting closer. Now, you started with a migraine, okay? Or for example, you started with, I don't know, peptic ulcer or
allergic
rhinitis. And slowly, you're going into a realm that, you know, this allergic rhinitis makes me feel so frustrated. You know, every morning I'm only sneezing, and it's so frustrating. I'm so fed up and angry with my complaints. Describe more. It's as if this allergic rhinitis has taken the life out of me. Now you're going deeper. How is this allergic rhinitis affecting your life? So this uniqueness comes out as you go deeper into case. And as you go deeper and deeper, till the delusion, till you are the imagination, you're still at the level of mind. Yeah, you started with the physical complaint maybe, and you reach the level of mind, you know. But now if you go deeper, and this is a very crucial phase, you're actually bypassing, you're crossing the mind and the body sphere, and you're going to a much deeper realm of experience of the patient. And here, something absurd, something illogical, you know, something beyond emotion, situations, symptoms, and pain, something global comes up, you know. And this same experience can be seen irrespective of the time, space, location, pathology. It will be seen in the patient's childhood, 10 years back. It is seen right now. It will be seen in the future. It will be seen in the dreams. It will be seen in the fears. It will be seen in the hobbies that the patient chooses. And this deeper sensation is found in, this is the underlying software that runs through everything. This experience of, you know, for example, feeling trapped, suffocated, freedom. Now, these sensations of feeling trapped or suffocated, or, you know, need for freedom, you can see it in, you know, his asthma. You can see it in his psyche that, you know, I'm feeling trapped in the job that I'm doing, in his relationship. It's global. Yeah, it's more general, and it's beyond mind and body. And when the patient is describing this sensation, more often it is with the energy. And this, as you go deeper into the sensation, you can't, because it's illogical, it's absurd, and it's also maybe beyond your conscious reality
and cannot express in words.
Yeah, it's difficult to express in words. Then you will start using energy. This energy will be, you know, through, you know, hand gestures, through movements, through colors, through sound, all of that. That intensifies, that qualifies, that describes this vital sensation more deep. And then you know if a particular vital sensation is with all these hand gestures and, you know, the squeezing and the crushing and, you know, I'm feeling suffocated, you know, I just want, you know, we had one patient who was given Hecla lava, for example. You know, he felt like anger, it builds up, the volcano builds up in a way that I just want to blast and just, you know, I want the entire world to be kind of destroyed. So if it is accompanied with energy and gestures, then you know that you're really at the vital sensation, you know, which is more global and which is more universal. And as you're going, when you are in this sphere of case taking, you know, when you reach this deeper level of subjective experience, you know, more often than not, patients are not, this is not their conscious field, you know. So sometimes, you know, they're saying something and then you will see that they suddenly either would feel weird or, you know, they'll just smile, you know, I don't know what, this is so funny, I don't know what rubbish am I talking, you know, or they would just hesitate, you know, they would not want to go here because this is scary, this is unknown, this is weird. What oftentimes can happen and which is so beautiful is that they become aware that, oh, this is something that is happening inside me and it's happening to me without my conscious knowing. And then, you know, the patient or the client can see this as an objective thing, you know, not as an an unconscious or a, you know, a script that is running through him, which rules his entire life. But, you know, he or she suddenly not only recognizes it, but can witness it, you know, like this. Oh, this is how it is. And then that witnessing, that level, that seventh level, if you reach, this is the time where a lot of healing and transformation can happen. You know, you're so close to your remedy, your other song, that the case taking can be miraculously very healing. Yeah. And to do this, to be able to reach this this sphere or this deeper sense of healing, you know, I mean, we use different methods. You know, we could use art. I mean, this guy, this kid is, you know, we talk about him a little bit.
Yeah, so he was a child of diagnosed with ADHD and hyperactivity, and was treating for his physical complaints also. And we found out that, you know, he was the special liking for the drawing and the art that he had. So we just wanted him to doodle something, you know, and we could find out that with this
to provide him the space, yeah, to express, you know, because so much of energy, you know, so much of hyperactivity and such small kid, you know, difficult to express. So through his art, we were able to, you know, go deeper, yeah, into his vital sensation and his reality. Similarly, you know, I did this thing on Facebook today, that what is your inner age? You may be anything, by your biologic age could be anything, but what is your inner age? If we are able to map patients with their inner age, that also helps us find the remedy, that how developed you are, you know, how developed is your ego to face the stresses that the outside world provide. It also gives us insights into what possible ailments you could be prone to, you know, what possible things that, you know, a lot of your vital sensations are also explained through this inner age mapping. And this is something that Dr. Mahesh Gandhi, you know, has kind of, you know, he's pioneered in this work. And that also helps us in our case taking process for our clients. We also use meditation. You know, we just ask the patient to come, just close your eyes and see what is happening in this moment. So a lot of our case taking begins with meditation or ends with meditation, or during the case taking, a deeper meditation space is created. And that level of witnessing is easy to achieve here. And that itself is so therapeutic. So along with homeopathy, Prajakta and I, you know, use yoga and we use meditation, as we mentioned earlier. And of course, we love homeopathy, but we can't forget that, you know, diet is the real fuel and what we eat is what we are. So, you know, we use different styles of, understanding the psychology of food and explore various options, you know, like veganism, or gluten-free, intermittent fasting and all of that. And we do this Zen counseling. So all of this we do, of course, in the couple of clinics that we have here in Mumbai. But we see patients across the globe, and if you or your family members, if you have any questions or would like to get in touch with us, please feel free to get back and or get back to your nearest homeopath. And once again, I want to thank Get Well with Homeopathy and Uta and Genova and everybody in the team who has kind of put this event in place. And Prajakta and I are very happy to be here.
So thank you so much for listening to us, and see you again.
See you soon. Take care of yourself. Bye-bye.